Good evening. She left us like she lived, with grace and dignity, and it seemed the whole world was watching. Queen Elizabeth II's state funeral service, unparalleled in ceremony and grandeur. A show of thanks deserving of Britain's longest reigning monarch, but equally an emotion-charged family farewell to a much-loved matriarch. Tonight, Her Majesty is finally lying at rest, reunited with her husband, Philip.
On the long walk in Windsor, they were commemorating the long life of Queen Elizabeth. She travelled from one end of the country to the other these last 10 days, but here the journey was nearing its end. Windsor Castle was her favourite home, and the 96-year-old was returning to it now forever, into the embrace of a welcome that broke all precedent. Crowds 50 deep, maybe more, an estimated 100,000. She was escorted by her treasured 1st Battalion Grenadier Guards, who'd raced home from Iraq to perform this duty, but not even they could stop the bombardment of bouquets. This was a day of spectacle and sadness. As the hearse entered the estate, it was the public's final glimpse. With the crowds held back, the road lined instead with hand-laid fields of floral tributes. The minute guns of the Royal Artillery marked her arrival, echoed 5 seconds later by the tolling of the Sebastopol bell. The first to welcome her home, Emma, one of the Queen's fell ponies. The 96-year-old monarch had been riding them only months ago. Horses, one love, corgis the other, and two were waiting for her arrival today, Sandy and Mick. As a child, Elizabeth had gone to Windsor to escape the wartime blitz and did the same throughout the COVID outbreak. It would be her refuge again in death. Son King Charles, the emotion told on his face, the rest of the family standing right behind him. The cortege wound its way through Windsor's grounds. Not far behind, second and third in line to the throne, Prince George and Princess Charlotte, here to farewell Gangan. The bearer party shouldered the nation's grief and carried it gently into St George's Chapel after a day that had brought this nation to a standstill. The journey had begun in London. After 4 days lying in state, it was time to lay her to rest. Carried from Westminster Hall and placed on the state gun carriage with choreographed precision. ...142 Navy personnel dragged the carriage to Westminster Abbey with ropes by hand. Something done for Queen Victoria, three kings and Churchill, now Elizabeth. On top of the coffin, the instruments of state, the imperial crown for her coronation in 53, the orb and sceptre. The wreath cut from the gardens of her palaces, including myrtle, grown from her own wedding bouquet 7 decades ago. Also there, a handwritten note from her eldest son, in loving and devoted memory, Charles R., the customary sign-off for reigning monarchs. Charles III, the new king. He, his sister and brothers walked behind the coffin, then sons Princes William and Harry. He and Andrew both banned from wearing uniforms. The silence broken by the bells of Westminster Abbey, tolling every minute for every year of Her Majesty's life. Waiting at the Abbey, 2,000 guests, Britain's greatest ever assembly of world leaders, royalty and dignitaries, including every living former British Prime Minister. Australia's PM was there as well with partner Jodie Hayden. The new Queen Consort arrived with Catherine, Princess of Wales, who kept Prince George and Princess Charlotte close. The 9-year-old schoolboy carrying a weight of expectation, his 7-year-old sister wearing a horseshoe brooch in honour of her great-grandmother.
This would be an ordeal for them.
It was an ordeal for all of them. Even Meghan, the Duchess of Sussex, seemed overwhelmed. At one point, King Charles battled tears. This abbey has played a central role in his mother's life. Elizabeth was married here, crowned as well. History was pulsing through this service.
In 1953, the Queen began her coronation with silent prayer, just there.
A coronation then, a commemoration now. A ceremony planned in detail by the Queen herself. This, a favourite hymn, sung at her wedding to her beloved Philip. Special sympathy too for the family she left behind.
And we pray today especially for all her family, grieving as every family at a funeral. But in this family's case, doing so in the brightest spotlight.
Then the last post, heralding 2 minutes silence across the nation. This was how the Queen wanted it to end. The sounds of the bagpipes she woke to every morning, now bidding her good night.
The piper turns and walks away. The sound in the abbey fades to nothing.
The 40th monarch in a line dating back to 1066, but her reign was like no other.
She was a monarch unmatched, living, serving, reigning longer than any other. Hers was a life unparalleled, as was this farewell today. Of all of the tributes that have been paid in the days since she died, this was the greatest.
Thousands participated, millions attended, and billions watched worldwide. All to say thank you for her lifetime of service. A woman who defined the generation, who kept calm and carried on. The household staff at Buckingham Palace lined up to say farewell, as did crowds 10 deep along the procession route. At Wellington Arch, her family again gathered, Her Majesty's coffin transferred from gun carriage to royal hearse for that last 40-kilometre drive to Windsor.
From
At Windsor, 800 guests and dignitaries, kings and queens, presidents and prime ministers. As the royal family took their seats, no one touched the one in front, where the Queen famously sat alone last year for husband Philip's funeral.
We have come together to commit into the hands of God the soul of his servant Queen Elizabeth.
The service was simple and straightforward, as designed by Her Majesty herself, including readings taken from the funerals of her father and grandfather.
And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying.
Memories of the late Duke of Edinburgh always present. This was played at his funeral too. And then the inevitable, indelible image of the monarch being stripped of the instruments of state, the scepter, orb, and imperial crown, all now headed back to the Tower of London, before one of the final ceremonial acts of the day, the breaking of the wand by the most senior member of the royal household, the Lord Chamberlain, the end of his service to the Queen, at the end of her service to us.
Go forth upon thy journey from this world, O Christian soul.
Then the Queen's coffin was gently lowered into the royal vault, her duty done. She would later be reunited with her father, mother, sister, and husband. A private service after days of public mourning for a woman who made history, who was history, a final family farewell.
And let's go to Chris Reason at Westminster Abbey now. Chris, while the Queen's very public goodbye has come to an end, the royal family remains in mourning.
Good evening to you, Mark. Officially, the nation was to observe a 10-day period of mourning. Well, that expired yesterday with the end of that funeral. But yes, for the royal family, King Charles has requested, it's his wishes that they observe an extra week, 7 days, taking them through till Monday. As we learn news this morning that one of the greatest displays of public mourning, the queues we saw forming for the lying in state, well, the numbers are out today. And officially, it drew a staggering 250,000 people over those 4 days. Mark?
Chris Reason in central London, thank you. Relatively few people, 2,000 in the Abbey, 800 at Windsor, could be invited to the funeral services, but millions gathered in streets, parks and on pavements to catch a glimpse of Her Majesty's final journey. Many expressed an irresistible urge to be there, to honour their Queen and to be part of history.
After years of national trauma, inflicted by politics and pandemic, this was Britain's longed-for moment of unity. The Queen, again, the conciliator, the touchstone, the beacon.
A huge sense of pride, seeing everyone here just to celebrate the Queen, everything she stood for.
Quite a moment in history, really, so just wanted to be part of it.
More than a million on the streets of London, Her Majesty's people packing pavements to say thank you.
She was a magnificent woman, and we were lucky to see her in this time.
She's a brilliant lady.
And in the pews at Westminster Abbey, presidents and prime ministers who can only dream of the soft power wielded by the late monarch. So many leaders, they came by the busload. From every continent, Emmanuel and Brigitte Macron, Brazil's leader, the US president, one of just a handful allowed to travel by car.
Good morning, Mr. President. Welcome to the Abbey.
But he was seated well back, trumped by prime ministers from across the Commonwealth. Six former British leaders, including Boris Johnson, who visited the Queen at Balmoral to offer his resignation just a fortnight ago. Justin Trudeau, Jacinda Ardern, Anthony Albanese. In a sign of how much this world has changed in 70 years, the Commonwealth formed a central part of proceedings.
O death, where is thy sting?
Canadian Mounties leading the procession, Australian, Canadian and New Zealand troops marching side by side. This proved to be a reunion of global royalty too. The Emperor of Japan on his first trip abroad since the start of the pandemic, and seated at the front, opposite the King, Queen Margrethe of Denmark, marking her own golden jubilee this year. She was Elizabeth's third cousin and good friend. King Harald of Norway, a second cousin. Elizabeth brought them all together, Israelis and Palestinians too, in a Church of England abbey. In death as in life, Her Majesty was a magnet for world leaders, often desperate for some of her mystical, majestic power to rub off on them. But this wasn't about politics. It was about honour, honouring a life that can't be matched in a modern world. Unrivaled duty, the ultimate farewell. In London, Hugh Whitfeld, 7 News.
The last leg of Her Majesty's journey up the long walk to Windsor Castle was a more personal affair. The Queen's past and present staff, many having given decades of service, were there, and neighbours wiping away tears as they said goodbye.
Windsor Castle and the rolling countryside of its great park, the backdrop to so much of the Queen's extraordinary life. Moments treasured by her local community, determined to share in this one too.
Extremely fitting that this was the final place of her journey and the final resting place will be next to her beloved husband for so many years. She always had a lot of personal love and respect for where she occupied.
London's farewell was grand. This felt personal. The congregation in St George's Chapel included staff, past and present, from the Queen's homes and estates, from caterers to her closest aides turned confidants. Throughout Her Majesty's final weeks and days, they were a near constant presence at her side. Today was no different. In front of her coffin, Paul Wybrew, who the Queen affectionately called Tall Paul, the 6'4" footman with her for 44 years, and the even taller Matthew McGee, her private secretary. Waiting to the side with Emma, the Queen's favourite fell pony, was Terry Pendry. He regularly went riding with Her Majesty, even in her later years. Locals already miss seeing their royal neighbour in that iconic silk headscarf, today draped over her saddle.
Yeah, I remember one year I was watching the dressage at the horse show, and the next thing everyone was standing up, and I'm like, why is everyone standing up? And obviously Her Majesty walked in.
Now, I mean, I even met her at Ascot Racecourse very briefly, and just to get that short smile from someone like that is just remarkable. So she really connected with people so well.
And not just people, her ever faithful companions, corgis, Mick and Sandy, waiting to welcome their master home one last time.
You expect her to be this wonderful persona, when in fact she's just very down to earth.
Windsor was the place the Queen would escape to, first with Sister Margaret as young princesses fleeing Nazi bombing in World War II.
My sister Margaret Rose and I feel so much for you, as we know from experience what it means to be away from those we love most of all.
80 years later, it was still Elizabeth's safe place, isolating with Prince Philip here throughout the pandemic and reassuring a nation once more.
We will be with our friends again. We will be with our families again. We will meet again.
All around Windsor, there are reminders of the Queen, of her lifelong legacy, a symbol of stability and resilience. For people here too, it is their memories, even for some, their fleeting encounters with Her Majesty in this park that they'll never forget.
For most who came to say goodbye, it's difficult to imagine the Britain of 1952 when Elizabeth became Queen, but it's even harder to imagine a Windsor and a world without her. In Windsor, Sarah Greenhalgh, 7 News.
Australia's VIPs at the funeral have told of the enormity of the experience, seeing the Queen's coffin and rubbing shoulders with world leaders. And despite the incredible security surrounding the service, one had an unexpected encounter.
Real Aussies, real stories from the funeral front line.
I burst into tears. Oh my goodness.
Valmai Dempsey, Australia's Senior of the Year, one of the 9 Aussie achievers invited inside.
And I looked across and there suddenly came the cask. And I looked and I thought, oh my goodness, this is for real.
Also seeing the coffin close up, Victoria Cross hero Daniel Kieran with a front row seat as the Queen came by. Fellow VC recipient Ben Robert Smith just metres away in the row behind. And earlier, emerging from a black London cab, our oldest cross medalist, Queensland's Keith Payne. His entrance upstaged by the Bidens, no less. Val had a presidential close call too after ducking outside for a trip to the loo.
And it was such an easy escape to the ladies, and suddenly there was a person in front of me and I looked up and good heavens, it's Mr. Biden. I said, oh, hello mate, how are you? And he said, I'm good.
They were all there, Anthony Albanese bringing his partner Jodie, and Governor-General Hurley there with wife Linda. Before the funeral, the Prime Minister and Governor-General were brought here to Chelsea, where they abandoned their entourages and caught buses to the service. They came by cab, they came by coach, but a chosen few left like this. 39 of our Defence Force finest joining Commonwealth armies from all over the world in the last of the Queen's great goodbyes.
Performed exceptionally well. In what I saw was their last duty for Her Majesty.
In London, Amelia Brace, 7 News.
Across Australia, more than 5 million people saw the Queen's funeral on TV, with many more watching online. From the Opera House to lounge rooms and pubs across Sydney, her final goodbye has meant a lot to a lot of people.
Her Majesty beaming on the Opera House, her funeral beamed into living rooms. By 8pm, more than 5 million Australians were glued to the service, the largest audience tuning into Seven's coverage. The Lord Nelson was one of Sydney's many British pubs hosting expats from across the Commonwealth.
Quite proud to be English, I think, when you see this.
Quite glued to the TV as well with the whole thing going on.
At St Andrew's Cathedral, where the Queen once visited, mourners gathered, filling pews and condolence books to be sent to Buckingham Palace.
Indeed, people are in tears. They've been in tears signing the condolence books sometimes, take a lot of time over their message.
From words written to those spoken.
One of the greatest monarchs the world has seen.
And those sung. This morning at the King's School, hundreds of students and staff spared more than a moment for the late sovereign.
For us, it's just, you know, important to stand true to yourself, stand true to your morals, and you know, I think that's what she represented.
With Her Majesty's funeral now behind us, a state memorial service will be held here at St Andrew's at 11 a.m. tomorrow. It'll precede several other significant services on Thursday, on our National Day of Mourning.
I think that the National Day of Mourning, the National Parliamentary Service, will be a closure, as it were.
Symbolic of said closure, the Harbour Bridge flags have been raised from half-mast to full, but the Queen will stay here, beaming, for now. Tom Hartley, 7 News.